I'm really a down-to-earth sort of man, so I've had very few such experiences. I have friends who have transcendental visions almost every night, but I've had these very rarely. One of them, and made a deep impression on me, was in a walk over the Brooklyn Bridge. I've walked over all the bridges, but the Brooklyn Bridge was my favorite. And one March afternoon, I started over on the Brooklyn side. The wind was blowing, there were heavy clouds in the sky moving around, but the sky was light enough to give a complete silhouette of the skyscrapers on the New York side. I began walking over it. And the course of it, I had a sense of the great star of life, the vitality, the power that lay beneath everything. There were the ships and tugs going up the East River. There were little curls of steam coming out of the skyscrapers. There was the sound of traffic on the bridge itself. And I was walking young and feeling happily alone. And I had a sense almost of my whole career or the world that I was going to live in being laid out before me. I had a sense of the power and glory of the present world.
In the spring of 1926, it was obvious to everyone that he was failing rapidly. By May, he was down to less than 100 pounds. "Think not that I am improving," he wrote, "growing weaker daily. Head bowed down in sheer apathy. Bones crack when rolled over. Fall down when I try to stand. Please leave me alone and in peace." But then he added a P.S., a surprise. For several years, 10, a night-blooming cereus stalk has been knocked about in the greenhouse. Last night, it suddenly bloomed. It was brought to my bedside at 10 p.m. A delicate odor filled the room, a wonderful flower, much larger than a rose. This morning, it is gone, to sleep the sleep of ages again. He lingered on for 2 more months. The only thing he had left, he said, was his brain. And for that, he added, he was extremely grateful.
There was a moment when, in my generation, back in the 20s, the generation of the 20s, when the Brooklyn Bridge dawned on us. Each one of us saw the dawn from a different angle, but there it was, it declared itself important. And this wasn't something that was exclusive to literary people or intellectuals. It was something that the ordinary man felt too, because he'd walk back and forth over the bridge.
In 1924, the poet Hart Crane moved to 110 Columbia Heights in Brooklyn, to the same room that Washington Roebling occupied as he directed the construction of the Brooklyn Bridge. There, Crane worked on his epic poem about America. To Brooklyn Bridge. How many dawns chill from his rippling rest, the seagull's wings shall dip and pivot him, shedding white rings of tumult, building high over the chained bay waters, liberty. Then with inviolate curve, forsake our eyes as apparitional as sails that cross some page of figures to be filed away till elevators drop us from our day. I think of cinemas, panoramic slights with multitudes bent towards some flashing scene never disclosed, but hastened to again, foretold to other eyes on the same screen, and thee across the harbor, silver-paced as though the sun took step of thee, yet left some motion ever unspent in thy stride, implicitly thy freedom staying thee. People working during the 20s whom he knew and knew well, Joseph Stella in painting, George O'Keefe in painting, in photography, Alfred Stieglitz, Bernice Abbott, in literature, John Dos Passos, Waldo Frank, all friends of Crane, were all involved in this same effort to see the linking value of a bridge that meant more than just a way to get somebody from Brooklyn to Manhattan and back again.
It's the growing consensus, visible through people's acts, and then gradually it seeps into thought, it becomes part of their the texture of their lives, it goes into pictures, it goes into poems, and before you know it, there it is, unescapably grand and solid and indestructible in the way ordinary works of art are not.
If you've been a rover, journey's end lies over the Brooklyn Bridge. Don't let no one tell you that I've been trying to sell you the Brooklyn Bridge. You'll miss her most when you roam, 'cause you'll think of her and think of home, the good old Brooklyn Bridge.
The towers of the Brooklyn Bridge are a sort of Gothic monument. They really tie the Brooklyn Bridge to the masonry city of the 19th century, while the Great Roadway, in effect, symbolizes the more modern city of the 20th century. And for a gate, for a symbol, one needs more than a sheer piece of technology. One needs something that expresses some sort of cultural meaning as well. And a great Gothic archway is a very noble entrance to a city.
Did you hear that siren?
Yes.
Tarzan.
I remember Louis Kahn, the great American architect who died couple of years ago, talked of great art as not the fulfilling of a desire, but the making of a new desire. He said that the world never really needed Beethoven's Fifth Symphony until he wrote it, and now we couldn't live without it. In a certain way, it's the same thing with the Brooklyn Bridge. We didn't really need it. We could have gotten across the river either in boats or in some uglier or very different looking bridge, but now that it's there, now that it's there, we couldn't imagine a world without it.
I feel that the bridge makes one feel better about being alive. I think it makes you glad that you're part of the human community, that you're part of a species that could create such a structure. We are builders, and when we see something that we've built well, our hats are off. We stand there and say, isn't it marvelous? But isn't it marvelous that it was built by people, people like you and I, people like we would like to be, at least, and brave, courage, the tenacity of those people, the confidence, all of those are, they sound like platitudes. They're truths. They're simple truths, but some truths need repeating, generation after generation after generation. And the Brooklyn Bridge continues to repeat truths that we need to remember.
As a matter of fact, there's nothing one can say about the Brooklyn Bridge that the Brooklyn Bridge hasn't already said to us and impressed upon us. So our minds have been affected by it, even when we're unconscious of it, I think. And it's part of our real inheritance. We realize eventually that with the scenes and actions of everyday life, to have a further future, not in a remote heaven, but in the minds of countless people, and that these scenes and acts and dreams then become transformed and permanently part of the human heritage. Although we couldn't single out any one person in a crowd and say, that's the man who's been affected by the Brooklyn Bridge. But millions of us have.
See, the city is fundamentally a practical utilitarian invention. It always was. And suddenly you see this steel poetry sticking there. It's a shock. It puts everything to shame, and it makes you wonder what else we could have done that was so marvelous. And so unpresumptuous. It carries its weights. It does what it's supposed to do. And yet, I mean, they could have built another Manhattan Bridge, couldn't they? And he didn't. He really aspired to do something gorgeous. So it makes you feel that maybe you too could add something that would last and be beautiful.
Anything more you want to know?
Nope. That's enough, son. I'll buy it.